So hi everyone, today we'll be talking about prion diseases. Okay, so before we go into the discussion proper, a few important features about prions. So number one, prions are purely made up of protein. They don't have any nucleic acid. There is no DNA, there is no RNA. And a unique feature of prions are they can present as different types. They can present as an infectious disease. It can present as a familial disease, and it can even be sporadic. This is a feature which is unique to prions. Okay, so the main hallmark feature of prion disease is accumulation of prion proteins, that is PrPSC configuration. So normally prion proteins are present in the cellular configuration. So they are normally present, they are present in the cellular configuration. So this gets converted into the pathological form, that is prion protein SC. Okay, so this is the hallmark feature of prion diseases. So PrP cellular isoform is actually present in an alpha helical configuration, whereas the PrP SC is present in a beta pleated configuration. Okay, so this is an important MCQ question. So PrPC is converted to PrP SC. Okay, now coming to the four important human prion diseases. So number one is Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, which is also known as subacute spongiform encephalopathy. So Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease has a lot of types. It can be sporadic, it can be inherited, variable CJD and iatrogenic CJD. We'll discuss about that shortly. So the second one is fatal familial insomnia. And next we have Gerstmann-Straussler Schimke disease, that is GSS and Kuru. Now coming to the etiology of CJD. So coming to the etiology of CJD. So CJD can be sporadic. The most common type of CJD is going to be sporadic CJD. The next most common cause is going to be familial CJD. The second most common cause is going to be familial CJD. And remember that prion proteins are encoded. Okay, the gene for prion proteins is encoded on chromosome number 20. This is a very important MCQ question. And the least common types are going to be the infectious types of CJD. There are two types of infectious CJD. So number one is iatrogenic CJD, which is due to dural grafts, post-corneal transplant, due to human growth hormone injections. So actually right now we have recombinant growth hormone injections, but back in the day they used to extract growth hormones from human cadavers, the pituitary of human cadavers. Next we have neurosurgical procedures due to infected equipment and infected intracranial EEG electrodes. Next, a very important type is variant CJD, because it has a very specific clinical syndrome. It presents in relatively younger patients. Okay, so this is basically the human form of bovine spongiform encephalopathy. So bovine spongiform encephalopathy is a prion disease in cows. So when the patient is going to consume tainted beef meat, okay, from a cow which is infected with or was suffering from bovine spongiform encephalopathy, it can lead on to variant CJD. Okay, so we'll discuss about all these types in detail in a while. Now coming to the epidemiology, it's very rare. Okay, it's a relatively rare disease. We have only about 1 to 2 cases for every 1 million population. And it's a disease of the older people. Okay, the average age of onset is around 65 years. Okay, so 50 to 70 years is the range. The average age of onset is 65 years. And the sex distribution is equal. Okay, this is an important MCQ. The sex distribution for prion disease is equal. And urban populations seem to be affected relatively more compared to rural population. Okay, so we discussed that prion disease is going to present in the elderly patients. So which types of prion disease, which prion disease are going to present in younger population? So number one is variant CJD. Okay, variant CJD is an average age of onset of 27 years. Next is obviously your familial types of CJD, and then GSS. So these are the three prion diseases which are going to present in younger population, in contrast to other prion diseases like sporadic CJD and fatal familial insomnia. Okay, now coming to the pathology. The hallmark pathological feature over here is going to be spongiform degeneration. The hallmark pathological feature is spongiform degeneration, where you have vacuoles, formation of vacuoles in the cortex, the putamen, caudate nucleus, thalamus, and the molecular layer of the cerebellum. Okay, so this is an MCQ question. Okay, along with astrocytic gliosis, and very important, there is no inflammation in the CNS. There is absolutely no inflammation. Okay, now coming to amyloid plaques. So amyloid plaques is not a common feature in CJD, but remember that it is a characteristic feature in GSS. So GSS is a prion disease that predominantly affects the cerebellum. So what happens here is you have amyloid deposition in and around the blood vessels. So you have a type of amyloid angiopathy. You have a type of amyloid angiopathy which is going to affect the predominantly the cerebellum. is seen in GSS. So here is central core of amyloid surrounded by smaller globules. And very, very important point over here is florid plaques. So where you get florid plaques, you get it in variant CJD. So basically in florid plaques, you have a central amyloid core made up of your prion protein SC surrounded by vacuoles in a petal-like fashion. So this is only known, resembling a flower. So this is only known as florid plaques. Okay, now coming to the clinical features of all the prion diseases. So the most common one is sporadic CJD. So remember, whenever you think about CJD, there are three clinical features that should come to your mind. So number one is going to be a dementia, a rapidly progressive dementia. Number two is going to be myoclonus. And number three is going to be a psychiatric syndrome, your depression, hallucinations. So whenever you have these constellation of symptoms, you should always think of CJD or prion disease. So before the patient develops his features, there'll be some prodromal symptoms of fatigue, sleep disturbance, weight loss, headache, anxiety, and malaise. Okay? And you'll have a psychiatric syndrome. Patient will have severe depression, psychosis, visual hallucinations, and a rapidly progressive dementia. Very, very important. Okay. So we have certain variants of CJD. Okay. So in case cerebral ataxia is going to be predominant, it's known as Brownell-Oppenheimer variant. And when visual disturbances are predominant, it's known as Heden-Hain variant. Okay. So these are important MCQs, especially for NMHANS. Okay. Then the patient can have extrapyramidal features. Seizures are rare. Okay. So of course the patient's going to have myoclonus. Myoclonus is obviously a type of seizures, but otherwise, other GTCS and all is not a presenting. It can occur, but it's not a important or presenting feature in CJD. Next, the patient can have supranuclear gaze palsy. And remember that that disease has a 100% fatality. It's invariably fatal and death occurs within 6 to 12 months. So CJD has a bad prognosis. Not only CJD, all the prion diseases have a very, very bad prognosis. Okay, next coming to myoclonus. So I told you myoclonus is one of the three important clinical features in CJD. It occurs in 90% of the patients and it appears late. Okay, myoclonus is not a initial feature in CJD. Initially the myoclonus is going to be unilateral. After that it ends up being generalized in the later part of the course of the disease. Okay, and very, very important point over here, startled myoclonus. Whenever the patient is startled, suddenly there's a loud noise, the myoclonus will increase. Okay, it's triggered. So this is known as triggered or it's increased. So this is known as startled myoclonus, very, very important MCQ point. And unlike other involuntary movements, myoclonus over here is going to persist even during sleep. Okay, it's not that myoclonus is something which is exclusive to CJD. Myoclonus can also occur in hypoxic encephalopathy and also in metabolic encephalopathy. But when you have these constellation of symptoms together, a patient with a rapidly progressive dementia, myoclonus, as well as a psychiatric syndrome, that time you should keep CJD on the top of your differential diagnosis. Okay, next, familial CJD is going to be similar to sporadic CJD, just that the age of onset is going to be earlier. Okay, so what are the other prion diseases with earlier onset? So number one is going to be variant CJD. We'll discuss about that right now. Next, as we discuss now, is familial CJD. And the third, what we're going to discuss now is GSS. Okay. So GSS, remember, it's a prion disease that predominantly is going to affect the cerebellum. There's going to be an amyloid angiopathy affecting the cerebellum. So ataxia, cerebellar ataxia is going to be the presenting feature and the predominant feature over here. Dementia is something that occurs late. And as we discussed, it's going to occur. The age of onset is going to be less compared to CJD, and the disease progression is slower. Death occurs only by 5 years, whereas in CJD it occurs by 6 months to 12 months. Okay, now coming to fatal familial insomnia. So as the name suggests, it's characterized by insomnia along with dysautonomia. You'll have autonomic dysfunction. Predominantly it's going to present as increased sympathetic activity. And dementia is not a early feature, it's a late feature. And the area of pathology over here is the medial thalamic nucleus. Okay, now coming to variant CJD is very important over here because it's going to affect very young patients. The average age of onset is only 27 years. And unlike sporadic CJD, dementia is not the initial feature over here. The important clinical feature over here is prominent psychiatric syndrome. Patient will have severe depression, psychosis, hallucinations, visual hallucinations, along with cerebellar ataxia. So in variant CJD, the psychiatric syndrome is going to predominate, whereas dementia is going to occur late. Okay. Now coming to the differential diagnosis. So I think you'd have understood by now that CJD is invariably fatal. So it's very important that we can look for other similar diseases which can be treatable. Okay, so that's very important to look for those diseases. So we have Lewy body dementia. So Lewy body dementia can also present with rapidly progressive dementia. Lewy body dementia can have myoclonus. So it'll resemble CJD. Next is Hashimoto's encephalopathy. Very important because Hashimoto's encephalopathy is going to have myoclonus. okay, it's also going to have a similar presentation as CJD. It's going to have a subacute encephalopathy. Even CJD is a subacute encephalopathy picture. Okay, so how we are going to differentiate both? And interestingly, even the EEG and Hashimoto's encephalopathy is going to resemble, is going to be similar to that of CJD. So the important points in favor of Hashimoto's encephalopathy, number one is the clinical course over here is going to be fluctuant. Whereas in CJD, the clinical course is monophasic. In Hashimoto's encephalopathy, the clinical course is fluctuant. Next, you're going to have very high titers, okay, of anti-TPO and anti-thyroglobulin. Okay, high titers of these antibodies. These two points are going to differentiate it from CJD. So, okay, and it's very important to identify this because Hashimoto's encephalopathy can be treated if you give the patient steroids. Okay, next, CNS vasculitis and paraneoplastic limbic encephalitis. So this also can present as a psychiatric syndrome with rapidly progressive dementia, but in paraneoplastic limbic encephalitis, you'll also have predominantly seizures, which is not a classical feature in CJD, but it's an important feature in paraneoplastic limbic encephalitis. Okay, now coming to the diagnosis. So the gold standard diagnosis is obviously going to be brain biopsy, where you're going to demonstrate prion proteins. But obviously this is not feasible and you're not going to do it for all the patients. So what we are going to do is MRA brain, where we look for the T2 weighted flare images and diffusion weighted images. In 90% of patients, you're going to have the classical abnormalities, that is cortical ribboning and hyperintensity in the basal ganglia. The most common neuroimaging abnormality is going to be cortical ribboning. It's an important MCQ question. Okay, now coming to CSF. CSF will be relatively normal, other than the fact that there's going to be an increased stress protein, that is 1433 protein. This is, however, not, it is sensitive, but it's not specific for CJD. Okay, so this is about our diagnosis of CJD. The last important point is EEG. Okay, so 60% of the EEG is going to be abnormal in CJD. In the early stages, you're just going to have some, mostly it's going to be normal or some scattered theta activity can be present. And the classical description of the EEG in CJD is going to be repetitive, high voltage, triphasic and polyphasic sharp discharges along with periodic bursts every 1 to 2 seconds. Okay, so this is the classical description of EEG in CJD. So I think I've been as brief as possible.